behalf of the family of Fred and Judy Miles, it is my privilege to welcome you and to thank you. You are showing your love and your care and your concern for the Miles family in a very tangible way. As a wise older pastor friend of mine said, you don't have to have all the answers when it comes to things like this. In fact, the less you say, it's probably better, but you do have to be there. And so I want to thank you on behalf of the family for being with us this morning. Let's pray together as we begin. O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servants may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory. And Father, you whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, we pray this morning that you would deal graciously with those who mourn. Surround them with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but rather have confidence in your goodness and grant them strength to meet the days to come. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God forever and ever. Let's hear this morning and take comfort in the Word of God. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. John chapter 11. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. Job chapter 19. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. Romans chapter 14. For we brought nothing into the world, and it is certain that we carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. 1 Timothy and Job. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be any mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Revelation chapter 21. This ends the reading of God's word. May he bless the reading of his word this morning. blessed this morning to hear from members of the family, beginning with Fred and Judy's daughter, Laura Kaczmarski. So Laura, if you would come, please.
Good morning. This is going to be hard. Sorry if I cried. That song was tough. I took care of my mom and dad for 5 years. And that song was played when she took her last breath. The whole family was there. My brothers, my niece and nephew. And we were very blessed that we could all be there with her. And my dad was there. And it was nice that we could be there with her. I wrote something down. I'm going to try to read it without crying. So, and this is from my eyes. My brothers would talk, I'm not sure if they're going to. So I had always seen my dad as a strong man that nothing could bring down. We always used to joke that he had 9 lives, and we always used to say because he always survived, like he survived a bullet when he was a kid in a hunting accident. He had these scars on his chest, and you could see where the bullet had traveled. He was hit by a bus while riding his bike, cut open his leg with a powder saw, and required 84 stitches. He fell 10 feet through a floor on a forklift while he was hauling a huge roll of carpet at work. After a family camping trip in the mountains, he came down with tick fever, and it made him really, really sick. He was having hallucinations and convulsions, and I remember us having to lay on him to stop the convulsions. My mom was sure we were losing him then, but he survived. He caught his hand on fire while lighting the grill. to getting lost in the mountains looking for ghost towns with my Uncle Bill. A train took out their dirt bikes that he and Uncle Bill were riding back then, and there were no such thing as cell phones to call for help. So a search party had to rescue them. Needless to say, the ghost town adventures were stopped after that one. My dad loved to go fishing and would sit there for hours. It didn't matter if he was catching anything. He just loved the sport. He loved to be outside tinkering around in the sheds or in the garden. He had a knack for coming up with these contraptions for something that he might need because he didn't want to spend the money to buy it. He would make a homemade TV stand or a plant stand or wheels to wrap up his extension cords. He was very inventive that way, and he always seemed to have it he needed to make them because he saved the oddest things. He liked to work on his vehicles to keep them in good running order and always kept up the maintenance on his houses. He was always there to lend a hand to my Uncle Jim if needed, or his friends and his family too. If they needed him, he was always there. Dad enjoyed having us kids and all of his grandkids together, along with any friends that wanted to come. That was when he was at his happiest. He would like to get the bags and the boards out, and we would play well into the evening. He loved that game more than anything, and he was really good at it. He was a competitor and was not easy on anyone. He played to win and didn't like to lose. He taught us all how to play and had some really good competition, especially with the grandsons. We all still carry on that tradition today and play as often as we can when we're together. Dad couldn't play much toward the end because of his breathing. But he still cheered us on when we played. loved Mom, his kids, and his grandkids, and the great-grandkids that came along. He wished he could have been closer to them all and seen them more often, but they knew he loved them, and he loved them, or they loved him. I'm sure if you asked them, they would say they all had a great time at family get-togethers. So you see, there wasn't anything in my eyes that my dad could not do. But when my mama passed, I started to see that my dad could not live without my mom. I knew it wouldn't be long, even though I had hoped it would. He wanted to be with his true love again, and from that day she died, he was never, never the same. Mama was my best friend, my safe place, my go-to person. She was my happy, my sad, my constant. If I had a bad day, was sad, had new her exciting news, or simply just wanted to hear her voice, I would call her. I called her on every holiday, birthday, Mother's Day, or pretty much any time I wanted to call. She would call me anytime she had the same things. I miss her so much, my heart hurts, and I don't know how to move on. Mama did everything she could to make sure her family was taken care of, and us kids had what we needed growing up. We didn't have a lot of money and times were hard, but she managed to make sure we had clothes on our backs and food on the table, and everything we needed for school. She taught us life lessons so that when we were ready to leave the nest, we could go out and be successful and raise our own families. When Todd and I were young, Mom managed movie theaters. And when on the weekends when the school was out, we would go to the movie theater with her. That was our babysitter. And we'd get our little popcorn in a hot dog bag, a little styrofoam cup, and we watched movies all day long. That was so she didn't have to pay daycare. I think we watched Superman, Star Wars, and Grease at least 100 times. And then we got to go up in the booth and watch how films were spliced together. It was really cool. She was really good at doing crafts, whether it be sewing, painting, or working with her hands. She made many dolls, bears, and blankets for the grandkids and for us. She loved working in her yard, flower beds, and her garden. She was really good at this, but when her hands started to fail, she gave up on it. She loved to garage sale, go to auctions, and play bingo with her grandma. She loved to travel with my dad and her brothers to different places and talked about the many places they had gone. She loved gathering for holidays and cooking tons of food, making homemade pies and homemade candy. She loved decorating for Christmas and said it was for the grandbabies. She loved to watch their faces when they all saw the lights and colors. She loved her grandkids more than anything. She loved being a grandma. She would talk about each one of them every time I called. She told me about their sporting events, school programs, how big they were getting, and more. She just couldn't get enough. She used to tell me there's nothing like being a grandma. Toward the latter part of the years, Mom's dementia started to get bad. She couldn't remember how to use a remote or dial a phone, but she could remember way back to her childhood. She talked a lot about spending the summers, I think it was North Dakota, on the farm with her grandparents, her aunts, and her uncles. Her and her brothers would go there, and she said they would have chores to do with the horses and cows, and it was hard work, but she loved it there. She spoke lovingly of her uncles and her aunts, as if she was back on that farm at that very moment. She also talked a lot of her brothers and how they would terrorize her and her childhood friend, Joyce. But there was so much love for her brothers, and she worried about them all the time. I loved her stories and listened intently because I wanted to know all I could so I could pass them down to future generations. Mama had a very strong faith and believed strongly in God. She prayed every night for the pain to go away, for the anger and sadness to stop, and for the safety and well-being for those she loved.
She prayed for her brother Michael, who passed in 2014. And for her older brother Fred, because she hadn't seen in a while. She prayed for Dad and that he would get better and not leave her. She told me these things in our many conversations, and she hoped she had been hurt. Our parents were married 63 years, took vows twice, 50 years apart, in good times and bad, in sickness and in health, and even death didn't part them. In all those years, they always said, "I love you," every day, with a kiss. The whole time Mom was sick, Dad never left Mom's side. One of the hardest things I have ever seen was my dad at my mom's bedside when God called her home. Then it was my turn to sit at my dad's bedside and wait for what I knew was coming. As hard as these moments were, and how much I keep reliving over and over, I thank God every day that I had the honor and strength to be able to be with them in their last days, hours, and minutes of their life. I will forever hold that in my heart until my last breath. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for loving me and showing me the way. We only get one set of parents in life, and I am very grateful to God that you know mine. My heart is broken living here without you. I know that one day we will meet again. Dad followed Mom into eternal rest 67 days later on January 29th, 2021 at 8:55 a.m. The very same time Mom took her last breath on November 23rd, 2020. Their wish was to come home, back to Fremont. My husband and I brought them home. And now they can rest. Fly high with the angels, Mom and Dad. Rest in peace with Michael, Grandma and Grandpa, and all of our family and friends who have gone before you. Love always your loving daughter, Laura.
Incredibly stubborn, yet they looked past that for each other in times when it was necessary to move forward together. An admirable trait that shows immense amount of love, strength, and endurance that truly fulfilled the words that they vowed to each other twice in their 63 years of marriage. best they could, and that was enough. I'm blessed to have been able to get to know them more and more each year as I grew up, getting to know who they were as people outside of just my grandparents, because it turns out they had a whole life before I was ever even thought of, which seems pretty crazy. Grandma was the oldest of three, the other two being twins whom she looked after and protected, unknowingly preparing herself for motherhood. She was a daddy's girl growing up, feeling a special bond. She was super crafty, always working on new crafts that Grandpa would usually hand make and then Grandma would paint or put together. She was fun-spirited and knew how to make you laugh in the moments you needed it most. Her voice was soft and sweet, always caring and reassuring. My Grandpa was a man of many talents and a man of many accidents, which made for many great stories in those reminiscent moments. My Grandpa was so fun and playful, always having fun and roughhousing with us kids, never going easy on any of us. There wasn't much that man didn't know how to fix. He could fix or make anything. I was recently told a story about how he fixed the family's dog's broken leg by putting it back in place and taping it to a wooden board. Eventually healing successfully and successfully saving money. Grandpa loved his office where he could play online pogo games and smoke his cigarettes. He liked playing cards, as did Grandma, like Rummy and Face 10, trying to cheat when he could and acted like he wasn't when he caught him. His playful and feisty demeanor added to the excitement of going to see them, which never let up even as I got older. After moving in with my Aunt Laura, my Grandma and Grandpa had to get used to talking on the phone and FaceTiming, which I'm not sure they ever really did, but they got the hang of it. They'd always ask about me and how I was doing, and my brother, and my Grandma would greet me with a, "Hi, Lauren," in a happy voice, like she was excited to talk to me. They always made it known how proud they were and how loved I was, regardless of what was going on with me. There are so many memories I could share. They were both spitballs of fire in their own unique ways, which naturally has distributed through our family tree, passing down some amazing qualities that may just live on forever. They were hard workers through and through, loving parents and grandparents, and they impacted many people throughout their life and saw a lot of the country traveling together. May their souls be at peace together forever, and I'm eternally thankful.
Thank you.
Funerals are unique times. We find ourselves trying to do a number of things, and those things are contradictory. We grieve. We've tried, I think, culturally to remove the idea that anyone should be sad ever, and yet, when we find ourselves bereft of a parent or a grandparent or a friend, grieving is our natural response. And so this morning, I think it's probably good that we remind ourselves that grief is a gift. We want to use it well. We want to use it wisely. We want to grieve well. The Apostle Paul reminds us that as we grieve, we are to grieve as those who have hope. The words that we read earlier on, that the Lord Jesus has conquered death and the grave, are words that should temper our grief. They don't remove them entirely, but they do temper them. For as Paul also reminds us in 1 Corinthians, that death has lost its sting. It has been swallowed up in victory. And we rejoice this morning, knowing that both Fred and Judy gave articulation to their faith and both clung to their faith, Judy for her entire life and Fred near the end of his. We also celebrate. Friends, if you can't celebrate 63 years of marriage, there's something wrong with you. What a wonderful gift to give to their children and their grandchildren. It's been said that those who have come before us will either serve as ghosts or they will serve as ancestors. Ghosts, of course, haunt you. Ancestors walk beside you. Ancestors are those who have offered their love and their grace and their forgiveness. And those of you who are kin of Fred and Judy are very blessed this morning. You are not haunted by the memory of Fred and Judy. No, you're blessed. They have left you a tremendous heritage. That leaves one last thing for us to do this morning. And that is that we need to answer a question. It's a question that Fred and Judy answered. And it's a question that we all need to answer. It's a question that Jesus originally posed to a woman who, like us this morning, was grieving the loss of someone she loved. Martha had buried her brother Lazarus. He'd been dead for 4 days. And in that time, funerals lasted a little longer than they do now. And Jesus comes to her and says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Now, here's the question. It's not just a question for Martha. It's not just a question for Fred and Judy, but friends, it's a question for us as well. And here it is. Do you believe this? One of the reasons I think we don't like funerals is that it reminds us of our own mortality. Someone has said death is the ultimate statistic. One in one will die. And it's true. It's true. So it leaves us face to face with the question that Jesus asked Martha. Do you believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? Do you believe that though we die, yet we might live? Do we believe that? Fred and Judy answered that question for themselves. And now, by grace through faith, we believe all the things that have been sung this morning. But what about you? Do you believe this? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the hope of the gospel. Thank you for the work of the Lord Jesus, that sin and death and the grave have been defeated. Lord, our hope this morning It's not that Fred and Judy were good people. They were. Our hope this morning is not based on 63 years of love and fidelity and marriage. That's a beautiful thing, but that can't conquer sin and death. Father, our hope this morning is in the finished and completed work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, that is what you call us to believe. And so we thank you for the hope that is ours in the gospel. We thank you for the way in which Judy and then later Fred laid hold of that hope for themselves. Father, we pray now in the days and in the weeks and, Father, even in the years that come, that your comfort would be upon the family as they remember, and they will, and as they celebrate, as they should, and Lord, as they grieve, which we know will happen as well, would you constantly be with them. We pray all this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Immediately following the service this morning, we are going to have an interment for Fred and Judy. You're welcome if you will just line up out in the parking lot behind. You'll see the vehicles there. And then immediately following the interment, there's going to be a luncheon to be held at Christensen Field. And so I've been asked by the family to invite you. They have plenty and would love for you to stay and to be with them in this time. I'm going to ask you now if you would stand. We're going to be dismissed in just a moment. But I want to dismiss us this morning with words of blessing. Words of blessing that come from the Bible. Here they are. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace from this time forth and forevermore. Thank you, and John will come and dismiss you.